I don't like being told something can't be done, so I built one anyway. My name's Ricky. Today I'm going to show you not only how I built this enclosure, but how you can build it too. If you haven't seen part one of the video, I suggest you go back and watch it first, otherwise this part two won't make any sense to you. So let's jump straight in. The first thing you need to do is add some fans to your side panels. Now, because I've put my 3D printer on a shelf, I've actually got a hole in the bottom of the shelf, which is my air inlet. All the fans pull the air out from here. If you want a different setup, just consider the direction of the airflow. You may want to turn one set of fans so they draw air in, and one set pulling the air out the other side, drawing the air across your electronics. Another option is an air inlet on the front surface below the door. This way you can draw air in at the front and out at the sides. If you're not sure, it's okay. We can just flip the fans around at a later date. I had quite a bit of a play around with my fan direction to get the best setup for me. Now take your printer, carefully lay it down on its side and unscrew the base. You're going to identify your 6-wire screen to motherboard cable and carefully remove it from both the motherboard and the screen. Remove the plug from the speaker cable. Undo the 4 screws holding the screen in place. Carefully remove the screen with the silicon gasket. This would be a good time to attach your screen to your 3D printed flange and then actually screw it into the front panel. Now you have a couple of options with how to attach this screen to the flange. I actually tapped a hole and used the same bolts out of the printer. But you could use small self-tapping screws to do this. Now we've removed what we need from the printer base, it's time to make up a couple of small wiring looms. First of all, get all of your supplies ready. You need some small spade connectors, fan connectors, heat shrink, soldering iron and solder, and of course, wire. All these things are linked in the description below. We're going to start by extending the screen wiring. You can cut and extend your original cable. I decided to buy new plugs and a couple of meter length of 3-wire flat cable. This way I can make a complete new cable, but also I've got the ability to just bolt everything back to original. The total length of this cable needs to be 1400 millimeters or 55 inches, that's plug to plug. So measure everything and cut your 6-wire cable where you need to get this length. Prep all your solder joints by stripping and tinning on the ends. Don't forget to add your heat shrink. Start by soldering one cable from one end all the way across to the other. When it comes to the other end, you want to solder everything in the reverse direction, as shown here. If in doubt, grab your original lead and check all of your wiring. Now, if you cut your original cable, just make sure as you lay everything flat on the bench, you should be able to see the same side of each connector pointing up at you. Now, once your screen extension cable is made, we can move on to the fan wiring. The fan wiring is very simple, but you need to pay attention to the voltage fans you've bought. I bought 24 volt fans, which makes the wiring very simple. You can just wire straight up to the positive and negative on the power supply. If the only option you have is 12 volt fans, you're going to need to wire them in pairs, and you're going to need to wire them in series, so that it splits the 24 volt down to 12 volt for each fan. Now, if you're not sure about this, don't guess it. The other option you have is to wire everything in parallel at 12 volt, but you need to use a 24 to 12 volt buck converter. I've simply got 2 fans that run out the front of the printer, which becomes the right hand side, and 1 additional fan, the standard fan, on the rear or left hand side of our enclosure. You can leave the wiring alone for the internal fan that blows out the back. The simplest way to do this is to give each fan 2 wires straight from the connector straight to the power supply, but you'll end up with multiple connections on the power supply, so you may just want to crimp a couple of those wires into 1 connector. Either way, just make sure every fan has got a positive and a negative at the right voltage. I would advise using plugs rather than hard wiring the fans directly into the power supply. You don't want to be screwing the fans onto the side panels as you're trying to assemble the whole enclosure. It doesn't really work. What's much easier is to just plug the wiring in as you put the side panels onto your enclosure. Now you only need the plugs to just exit out of the printer at both the front and the rear. Take the front connectors out of the screen hole, take the rear one out of a vent or something. There's plenty of holes in the back of the printer. Now, I extended the wiring for the main power socket so that I can move the socket to my enclosure. If you're not 100% confident with doing this yourself, simply buy the right angled power lead and run the lead through a hole in the side of your enclosure and plug into the normal socket. Make sure you leave the switch in the on position when you come to putting your printer back into your enclosure. run your screen extension cable out of the same hole that your heated bed wiring goes out of. Once we've finished all of our wiring mods, it's time to put the base back on the printer and stand it back upright. Now test everything. Plug your screen in and make sure it comes on when the power's turned onto your printer. And also make sure all your fans work by plugging them all in and testing. If you have anything not working, now's the time to go back in and investigate why. Once you're happy that everything works, it's time to think about assembling your enclosure in the position it's going to stay in. Start by assembling the rear and right hand panel together. Attach your 3D printed finger guard to your divider panel and then place it over the top of the printer. Lift your printer into the position it's going to stay in and then attach the rear and right hand panels to the divider panel, remembering to plug in your fan wiring before you screw everything together. Attach your left hand panel, connecting any power and fan wiring you need to as you go. Now take your top panel and place it in position. If you're going to add any LEDs, now's the time to do it. I cut my LED strip into three lengths and put connectors in all of the joins. This is because I'm going to be taking my enclosure apart and putting it back together again when I do all my future mods. If you don't think you're going to be doing this, it's not a problem. You can just run the strip all the way around, side, top, and the other side. Make sure you leave the wiring on the left hand side so that all the power connects it together at the same side. If you've been enjoying any of my videos, then why not think about supporting the channel? Just click the Buy Me a Coffee link down below. Don't worry, you don't have to actually buy me a coffee, but if you click follow, you can see what I'm up to next and see how you can help the channel grow. Cheers. Now in future videos, I'm going to be returning to the wiring with hopefully some kind of switch panel on the left hand side here. But for now, I just control everything with a switched extension lead so I can turn the printer and LEDs on and off separately. Once you have all your LEDs wired in, you can attach your front panel and then plug in your screen extension cable to the back of your screen. Before installing your screen rear protection panel, cover it in the aluminium tape to protect it and the rear of your screen from any heat from the enclosure. Align the screen wiring in the slot as you attach the panel, make sure you don't grab any of the wires. Attach this rear protector with some small self-tappers, make sure they're not too long so that they don't come out the front of your enclosure. Now you can attach the door and make sure the printer can move to its full extent without anything snagging anywhere. The large flat cable can be turned 90 degrees to easily fit inside the enclosure. All that's left to do is drill a small hole in the top panel that will allow a small section of Bowden PTFE tubing to be inserted for your filament to run through and into the enclosure. You want to align this hole directly over the top of where your filament feeds into the printer and about an inch or 25 millimeters back from the front edge. Make sure you don't go drilling through any LEDs you've just put there. Now you can just screw the original spool holder to the top surface of your printer and have the filament feed in that way. But I'd advise building my ultimate filament storage dry box so you can keep your filament dry whilst printing. Now these are designed to feed directly into the top of my enclosure, but can equally be used on any other setup you have. You now have a fully functional 3D printer enclosure. But before we go, I just wanted to say a few words on safety. 3D printers are electrical devices with moving parts. There's always a risk of malfunction and potentially a fire. Now, as an absolute minimum, I would always recommend a smoke alarm directly above your 3D printer and some kind of fire suppressant device, whether that be an automatic fire extinguisher or one of these fireballs, which automatically goes off if any fire is detected. These devices are not expensive and can save lives. Now, as my 3D printer sits in my garage and I can't sit and monitor it 24/7, in parts 3 and 4, I'll be adding remote monitoring and power control, along with separate heating and ventilation to remove any nasty fumes once I start printing things like ABS. Make sure you subscribe so you don't miss when I release these. And drop me a comment if you end up building this enclosure for your printer.